New Arts Alive features the guest artists who will share their work for a better understanding. New Arts Alive features the guest artists who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carrol. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions. Hello there, I'd like to welcome you to New Arts Alive, and I'm James Carrol. And with me, my guest is Linda Francis. And Linda Francis and I will, I'll be talking with her about her work. And what is the medium, basically, that you use, Linda?
Most of the time I do drawings. I'm best known for that. I use chalk and paper and eraser.
And Lots of eraser.
I like to keep it as simple as possible so that my ideas are the primary thing.
Now, going back when I first met you a long time ago, we won't go into how long ago, you not only did drawing, but you also did painting.
I still do.
But basically it's still on paper what you primarily work with.
Right. I occasionally I find myself doing a group of paintings, and as a matter of fact I've just started a group of paintings now. But I find that drawings are easier for me, and they're better because roughly what I'm dealing with are ideas. And I need to get them down fast, I need to embody them quickly, and I'm less interested in the surface, although the surface is very important. I spend less time on the surface than a lot of painters would do.
Okay, now the first slide that we have, you had mentioned before that it had to do with what you think about.
Right.
Oops.
There it is.
Ah, there it is.
That's a close-up of it.
Yeah. And
well, this is, I did this after I read a biography of Ludwig Wittgenstein. Now, that philosopher is, I think, more than anyone, the person who's defined the sort of area of the metaphysics of the 20th century. And the problems with it, and the area of investigation for most of us in the arts and philosophy. Basically, this says, why don't I read it? It says, this circle is 6 inches long and three and a half inches wide. And of course, that's an anomalous situation. The circle is not. And what Wittgenstein is dealing with is a difference between language and reality, and exactly how both these things are approximations and they don't quite meet up. And basically that's what I deal with too. Things that you can't see, try to make them visible. things that you can't do and try to make that visible too. Anyway, the other thing that it says there is that this man is small or very far away. And clearly, if you were some sort of untutored person, you might think that that picture was of a very tiny man, as opposed to being a man that's way far in the distance, which is a tutored point of view. Because we understand three dimensions, or rather dimensionality, by a lot of codes. And we know that if, for example, the writing is that big, that the man is actually not a little man. He's not a dwarf, but he's far away. And finally, it's kind of romantic. It says that Ludwig understands that everything seen is not said. And that, I think, is self-explanatory. So I think that...
That's in a nutshell.
Yeah, that's pretty much what I'm interested in.
Okay. Now then, what we would like to do next is go into some of your most recent work. And the work that we are going to see tonight deals with what period of time?
From starting with 1991, and there are only a couple like that, but mostly 92 to 96 was a good...
92 to 96.
Right.
So the first ones we're going to see are about 92 then.
Yeah, 92. Yeah. But they're not exactly in order, although the last ones are the last ones. But
okay, there's one other thing that first we should sort of clarify, and that is that what kind of basic training did you have that led you into the type of work that you do? It's quite important, I think, for you anyway.
Yeah.
And because you didn't come from a studio background.
Right.
That was later in life.
Right.
You came from an academic background.
Right.
Ray! but go ahead.
I really went to college kind of late. I didn't go directly from high school the way most people do, because I didn't know what I was doing. But when I got to college,
right.
Now I've made a career out of it. So, but I went to school, and when I went to college, I began studying chemistry, and more specifically, I was going to get into biochem. And I realized later that it was because I liked what I was looking at through a microscope and things like that. But, and also the ideas that I have are ideas about relationships of form and structure of form. And I suppose I could have made some sort of a career in biochem as well, I think. I think there's a great overlap between observation of structures and science, the artistic one and the scientific
bio
one.
Bio and also physics.
And physics, right. Well, you have to know, I mean, at the level that I stopped was a kind of rudimentary level. So I was involved with taking physics courses, biology courses, chemistry. I was embarking on this as a career. Unfortunately, or fortunately, I made a painting in between that. And before that, I had no idea what that was. But I just, for the hell of it, are you allowed to say that?
Okay.
A brush, and first I picked up charcoal, actually, and made a self-portrait just for fun. And apparently, I was sort of shocked myself at how easy it was for me to get a likeness, and a rather evocative one at that. And and also the kick that I got from it, a very, very big kick. And I thought to myself, gee, maybe this is what I should be doing instead of slaving behind some microscope looking at things that aren't exactly interesting.
No, but what you've done is sort of opened that up to where everybody can see it instead of the person
right.
who's looking down into the
right.
Microscope.
Right. I think that what is interesting in life are structures. There are structures in the physical world. There are structures in the mental world. I think they're the same or similar. And I think they're analogous. And I think we can show those visually.
Okay, now we have a group of slides that we're going to see next, and it consists of five slides. And can you sort of introduce us, and we'll go to the slides?
Okay.
Go ahead and tell us about what is.
Okay, this is I'm picking the. These are two separate drawings. They're pretty large. The slide on the left is the one which I have a detail of coming up, which is the one that is kind of a paradigm. It shows my ideas about form and rather on a building block elemental point of view.
It's almost like atoms, isn't it?
Well, it is. And I mean, it isn't specifically atoms, but it is certainly not visible. You know, it's really about elements. And what I see here, what I'm showing here, is the darker ones are what my idea is that things, of course, not just my idea, it's true. Things are in constant oscillation or revolution, and there are many things in dimensionally in every way you can imagine, and everything is jiggling around, as Richard Feynman would say, who is a great physicist, really, of our time. Everything's jiggling around in constant motion. Everything's affected by its own motion and the motion of everything around it.
Okay, what's the one on the right?
Well, okay. The one on the right is part of that. Again, it happens to be a lineup of two very simple kinds of motions which get this kind of funny pattern. And it's an improbable thing. The pattern is written on top of these balls that would be in revolution. But at the same time, it's kind of an acknowledgement to me that it's kind of like a string that lines up at one point and we seem to be able to see a sense out of it and a pattern and a rhythm in it.
Okay, then we have, this is the detail that you have.
Well, if you get further back from the detail, you can see.
Okay,
there's the kind of jiggling, which was sort of not visible from the first slide. And if you keep spinning and spinning around on a small level, you can. My idea was that gradually these spins become larger. In other words, they build up and they become visible on a larger level. So you'll see the wave going through the center there is really the result of many lined up small revolutions, makes a large wave. I mean, when you look at an ocean, you see some very similar phenomena.
These are charcoal.
These are chalks.
Chalk.
Yeah, yeah. I don't use charcoal.
These were actually on exhibit last spring.
In Kutztown,
right. At the NAP program.
Right.
They're how large on a piece of paper? What size?
The paper was about 40 by 50 or 40 by 45 by 55.
So these are not.
They're not
tiny. Larger,
yes,
yeah. Than one would carry with them normally.
Yeah.
Okay. Now this form.
There's another crazy one. Well, that's just a very similar thing. It's a sort of a building block idea, and the blocks are pretty much invisible, except that they are revolving, and that makes them describe circular paths. And in this case, I've joined them together, and they sort of come down into a cone.
So we don't see individual balls.
No.
We see them fused.
Right. Well, fused or moving so
almost
fast
like
that.
Almost like a wedge.
Yes.
Shape.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, generally, my point of view is that anything is the result of a kind of an accident of stability. In other words, things will join together in such a way that it produces a certain stability which allows it to exist in the world which we call real, or the visible world. Here's another wall of things. Actually, that's pretty black. These are black and red, or gray and red.
The red?
Yeah, I think it won't come out in this slide. Maybe next slide. There, I show it again in another slide. Maybe it'll be more visible. There's a red band around this, so I won't describe it until it comes up again.
Okay, what's next
yeah,
to the right?
Yeah, let's look at the right ones. Okay, see, these are black and red too, and you can see the red better. Pretty much, it's very simple. They're a kind of disorderly bunch of spheres and an orderly bunch. And that's really what that's about. And they don't exist in any space that you can possibly rationalize, but there they are. This is an orderly bunch of spheres or circles, which kind of fall on top, somewhere on top of this bunch of disorderly ones. And somehow there's the conjunction in space in our eye, which is unlocatable, really, but which we see here, and we make that association that somewhere they exist in the same space. But if you look at it closely, you start to realize that the positions are not locatable exactly. Okay, that's a good one. There's a close-up of that. See see, it shows a kind of a regular patterning of the red ones, but they fall on a place which is, you know, which in space is totally unfathomable. But I think we see that way. In other words, we see associatively. We make the mental association that there is a space there, that they are two like forms, in this case spheres or circles.
Okay, I think that's the last of our
of that group.
Slides. And what we're going to do is now going to shift over from your sketchbook that you have, that you brought with you. And this sketchbook, we have two pages that we're going to show. And here we have on the right, just random drawings, random marks. And we can see a kind of a funnel, which is showing the, at the top there, showing how they fuse or could be fused in. And then the bottom sections is showing them like you had them.
Well, yeah.
So to speak.
Yeah. I call them my doodles, but my sketchbook is tons of conjectures or doodles. These are all what would happen if I just made a whole bunch of balls or circles in a hexagonally close packed or in line, as you would say, and just made some black and left others not. What does it look like? What does it look like something in fact?
Well, most people right now might associate them with baseballs.
That's right.
I mean, because of
they would.
The thing that's going on with baseball on TV and our public.
Actually, I should have brought a slide of that. I didn't.
Of the baseball?
Yeah, I did one which is a baseball, and then I took it apart, and the two pieces that make up a baseball don't look anything like the sphere of the baseball. It's real interesting.
Okay, we'll be seeing your second drawing.
Oh, I know. Yeah, okay.
You mean you know what it is?
Yeah, no, yeah.
It won't be a surprise?
No. The backside of the first shot
that we saw.
Yeah,
this is
was visible just on the left-hand side. I do these drawings figuring out all kinds of dense patterning of overlapping spheres and overlapping hexagons, which is what this case is. If you notice on top of that, there's a little motif that's a kind of rotating triangle. And that is found, believe it or not, inside this pattern, which I figured out. I do it also in I do parts of it in magic marker so that it reads through the back of the page, which probably you don't remember, but you saw in the first.
Yeah.
So that it reads through without all the other information. I could pick out that plainly.
Do you ever make any of those in?
No, but I use them.
Structure?
No,
physical,
but
dimensional.
Oh, no. Now, sometimes I have made little models, if that's what you mean. Yeah, occasionally. Yeah, occasionally made little models. But I don't really. I haven't really ever. There's so many things I never get to do because I have millions of ideas. But that's why, mostly why I do drawings, is because I can work rather quickly and keep making a lot of them.
Okay, we have another set of slides, which are seven, in which we will be going to. And would you go ahead and sort of lead us into what these slides are? What is the group about?
I can't remember what the first one is. I think there. Oh, did we do that one already?
Here we are.
Oh, there we, okay. It's where we left off. This is that one that came out black in the beginning. And this, as I said to you, was sort of black and gray and red. And there it is. I call this red band. And it is obviously five gray spheres. And inside them,
pentagons.
They have five red outlines. Except, I mean, where in the world do you outline a sphere? So here's the thing about this. It shows you many, many edges simultaneously. In other words, you see the edge of the center flat on the paper. You see the edge of the outside flat on the paper. But the red band is describing another edge, and it's describing the edge as if you were walking around the surface of a sphere. And so to me, that is a kind of paradoxical statement. What does a two-dimensional edge look like as a silhouette? What does a three-dimensional edge look like? That's that one. Okay?
Okay.
Now, here's this group. I'm really showing my a kind of a bunch of things that are based on pentagons and hexagons, because they take for granted, some of them, that there's also a sphere in the middle. But this is pentagonal in a sense. It's five spheres put together, and I've simply made lines and erased those white lines are erasers, I should say, in the kind of a fabric of chalk, which I've loosely put in. And the only thing about the lines is that they are concentric and parallel, but they do describe curves. And it's a kind of irrational, rational form to me, with this sort of curving space everywhere that doesn't just stop as a sphere, but rather joins together.
I don't know if our audience has ever worked with chalk, but it gets pretty messy.
Oh yeah, a friend of mine used to say, oh, call me coal miner, because of the way I looked. When I'd finished working, I'm totally...
Oh, you're covered.
Yeah, covered.
Oh.
Totally covered. But that's what I like about it, because it really has such substance, and I'm really interested in that. I really like the feel of doing it. In a way, it's like sculpture. When you see my work in actuality, it looks... The tactile sense is very strong, and I think that's very important. I mean, I feel my way around these as well as think my way around them.
Okay, we have some more slides, don't we?
There's that one again.
Okay.
Oh, here's another one. Now, here you
see... six.
Here you see six, right.
And with three, what do you call those? Tangents?
They're just there, yeah. What happens is I just lined them all up, and then I said, oh, wait, I see this. And then I took out the other ones. I just sort of erased them. But generally what I did was a sort of silly thing, but I get a kick out of it anyway. I noticed, filling those in black, I noticed that the little curved triangles where they don't quite join were very beautiful. And so I took a line and I went the opposite way. In other words, I made curved triangles that were opposite and joined them together, and you have there a little outwardly curved hexagon.
Fits very nice in the monitor frame, doesn't it?
It does.
Okay.
Here's another pentagon hexagon. And here I had put together six circles, which were more thought of as spheres. And I thought of this as picking out conjunctions of spheres. So I was picking out 1, 2, 3, and 4. So if you get a long shot on it again, I'll be able to show you that configuration. Right, the number one would be the center one, but if you notice, you can see another grouping of four there, which are picked out, and that's a kind of a symmetrical grouping. Out of something that looks asymmetrical, there's also a symmetrical grouping possible. And then number three would be where they join up, and I've made the dark area out of three of those joining circles.
Sort of like the development of a universe, or the development
kind of. It's sequential, except that it's overlapping. You know, I see the thing as sort of knocking out any idea of sequence, but that the real things are not sequential, but they're simultaneous. And so I'm looking at that, and I'm counting six, and then I'm counting five, and I'm counting four, and I'm counting three, and I'm counting two. Sequentially, but not really, but all at once. And that's what my attempt to sort of pick that out and give you that idea without you having to rationalize it. Here's another example of that.
This is five.
This is five, but I've made a dark outline around four of them, and you get this, what I think is a very nice shape.
It also makes it flatter.
It makes it flat, exactly. It turns
with
it into
plane
a flat.
Of the paper surface.
Exactly. It turns into a flat plane, and one that's a little bit irrational, and where you start to see the overlapping balls as patterns, as flat patterns. But at the same time, you're aware that they have some dimension to them, so they're sort of pushing and pulling themselves back and forth.
You know, when you see a bicycle wheel go around, they have some similar, because it's flat.
Yeah, well, it's flat. It's interesting because a bicycle wheel, when you think of one, you think of it being flat, you also think of it moving. And I think that all of these, in my mind, are based on mental and physical moving. Not an illusion of motion, but a movement, a sort of associative movement.
Mental
motion, right. Well, here's one where I got really about that. I just put a bunch of balls together and made a lot of lines around them as though I were winding yarn around them. And then I sort of found that parts of them lined up and made other forms and started to make other circles and started to make lines and things like that. And I just loved it. And I left it there. It's just a crazy bunch of things. It's irrational entirely. Well, there's a place right there where there's a whole lineup of...
Well, arts in many ways is irrational.
Yeah. Well, things are irrational. I think we see things by trying to make them rational. I mean, we pick out order in things that somehow, sometimes is not there, but very often is there. This is another one of sort of disintegrating, moving sort of semicircles or whatever. I mean, I imagine that real atoms look like this. Although that's not the point of my doing it, but I imagine that's really what things look like on an atomic level. That's the end of that group, I think.
Okay, well, we won't go on to that one. When you start working with charcoal,
yeah.
What do you do? Just put it on and then...
Chalk,
excuse me.
Yeah.
Do you put it on, then start taking the eraser and going through it?
Yeah, that's what I do.
It's purely, you make it black, so to speak, or you make it...
Most of the time. Sometimes if you see the line, you'll see that I make a line that's black. And then I'll go through that with an eraser, too. So I think that the eraser, I draw with an eraser, and I draw with black line. And that's how I look at it. Some people use black and white. I use black and negative.
I like the word eraser better than negative.
Basically, the line is usually... A line is, there's a dialogue between what's etched and what's drawn.
Okay, now we have another group of three slides. Now, what are they specifically involved with? And what is the time span with these three?
These are small paintings, and they're fairly recent. I did them in, I guess, 95.
When you say
paintings.
Well,
they're not three of them. No, I'm sorry. Two of them I did in 95, and one I did in 87 or whatever.
When you say painting, what do you mean?
Well, I mean paint on...
Canvas,
in this case on wood. I think that this is hard to see, probably. Now that I'm looking at the monitor, it's a little difficult to see it. Maybe if you can get a close-up of it. What I did was I made a... Yeah, I made a grid, actually, of ellipses. And then I took another line. I made them, it's gray and white. The ellipses are gray. And then I took another line, which is black, and I simply traced around as though those ellipses really were curved surfaces that were joined. And it's kind of like a thread that moves from surface to surface, very much like a Mobius strip is. It's a single surface that keeps going and keeps attaching to itself and creates space and creates form. And that's what I did here. And it's a kind of a
what's the size of this?
This is, they're small. It's about 30 by 30. It's a square. It's actually a diamond. I put it on this corner this way because I think so it won't get locked into dealing with itself as a square. In other words, since I'm dealing with the curve, I don't want to refer to the square. So I put it on a diamond, which is a much more, it references oblique kind of motion more than it does the square itself. So we go to the other one. This is a much earlier one. This was the one from 87. And there again, you can see this is canvas. It's again gray and black and white. The ball on the right is really just brush stroke gone around, gone on top of a black flat circle. And it created this illusion, kind of like a yarn looking thing. But that's really an idea about...
But what size is that ball?
The ball?
Paintbrush stroke.
The paintbrush is probably 2 or 3 inches, wide.
And,
yeah.
then the whole, what's the circumference of?
Of the ball, I don't remember.
Or diameter?
I don't remember. But I think the whole painting is, again, probably no more than 32 or something high by 30 wide.
Two pieces?
But no, each
all
one.
Together?
Each one. Yeah.
About the size of the other one, then.
Each somewhat. One is about the size of the other one, but a rectangle, not a square.
Yeah.
Okay, here's just a line. Now, this to me is a square, but it isn't. It really describes a sphere. Now, you can squint your eyes and see that it actually goes back in space, although it's drawn extremely flatly. It's just perfectly flat, and it's drawn as a symbol or a pattern. However, it is as if you were to take this line and curve it around a baseball. That is the line, by the way. That is the way a baseball looks. If you go and follow around the seam in a baseball, that's what you'll see. Amazing that people don't realize that flat patterns, in fact, are very much curves and very much refer to space without us even being aware of it. So there to me are two analogs, in other words. There's another one, which is a more graphic example of that. That's a sphere. This one is about, again, it's something like 20, no, wrong. This is small. This is 16 square. And it's a painting. It's paint on board or wood. Again.
When you say paint, is it oil paint?
It's oil paint, yes. I always use oil paint. It's a nice, soft, lovely medium.
Fluid.
Yeah. And it has a great capacity for being transparent, although I don't use it transparently per se. So here's something I call a one twist, a single twist, I call this. Well, that's self-explanatory, I hope. It's as though the edge, again, of this circle came out and twisted around in a space which is infinite, which is a curved space.
Have you ever seen those bandsaw blades in which you can flip them and they'll go into a circle, so to speak?
I think I've seen them, yeah.
But not all together like the way you buy it.
Right.
But because right away I start thinking of that.
Of that. Well, it's their intention. I think that's why they do that, too. Yeah.
I think that's the end of the group of slides that we have for this, isn't it?
I think we have others.
Well, we have more slides.
Oh, yeah.
Of that group, yes.
Yeah.
Now then, I think it would be good to show that video slide. The video that we have, which is about 45, 50 seconds long, but it sort of shows all of this work in your studio.
Mm-hmm.
And if we could we have that shown, please?
That was in 93 or 4. It shows paintings there, you see, being developed, and it shows some of the drawings that I showed you. That's being developed, and that's kind of the way my studio looks.
Size relation is what we can get now in the reality of it.
Those are little sketches that I have a wall full of little sketches, and now let's see if you can see. Well, I don't know if you can get.
See those circular.
The paintings you see there are roughly 8 feet, usually 8 by 7, so you
pretty
can tell.
Pretty close to being square. Almost.
Well, not
off,
quite.
Just off,
yeah.
Square.
Yeah. So that's the smallest, what you see now, getting to be much bigger. And as you can see, I work a lot with, there's the baseballs, they just came up there. I work a lot with gesture, so in paint, the gesture is quite large, and so the paintings are pretty large.
That pan of your studio was shown twice, and it just went zip.
It's true. Well, I'm sorry.
No. But it seems quicker each time I see it.
Yeah, well.
Okay, now the next set of slides that we have, there are 5 of them. What are they particularly dealing with?
Let's see, where did we left off at the paintings? I'm not sure. Can you put the first one up for me, please?
I think we.
Okay, good. It's where I managed to put them in a group so that one sort of runs into the other. This is, if you remember, the one on the left is the one which we looked at a close-up of, where I went around the little triangles with a backwards curve.
Yeah.
Next to it is the reverse, It's actually, I call that, by the way, the obverse. I call this drawing the inverse. I took the outlines, it's hard to see in the slide, I'm afraid, but I took the outlines of the circles and I put them inside. And so you get this kind of lacy pattern, which is really bringing the inside edges, I mean the outside edges inside and breaking up the circle. And it kind of looks more like an X-ray. It's kind of interesting idea.
What's the group of work that we have to the right?
To the right? Okay, now this is where I'm going. So if we go back, if we take a long shot of that, okay. This is my thinking of a grid as being curved, okay? Not the usual square grid that people work at, but rather as a curved grid, infinitely curved in space. And I sort of brought out these simple four curves, which are not so much meant to be flowers or anything like that, as they are just a simple north, south, east, and west curve. But if you see the drawing itself, you realize there's a play against the flat pattern that makes and against the way it curves back into space. The other thing about it that sort of brings me into the next group of things I'm going to show you is that it was a kind of symmetrical thing. It was bilaterally symmetrical. On the top, it curved one way. On the bottom, it curved the opposite way. And this leads me to a group of things that I've been doing since 1979, which is drawings of various galaxies and the forms that they take. And these are about spirals, the most, to me, amazing form in the world. I think that everything is a spiral of some nature, of some sort.
Well, in fireworks, they call it pinwheels.
Yeah,
so
okay.
So it has that kind of
right. Well,
forcing out.
Right, it has to do with motion
or
again.
Or in,
right.
You can.
Right, it's about centrifugal force, it's about radiating forces. Again, it's analogous to taking a mass and sculpting the mass with some force, a force that's unseen. So essentially I'll treat the chalk like a mass and the eraser as a force, and I'll sculpt that in as though I'm rotating. I'm actually rotating my arm and sculpting these kinds of forms that come out of that movement. Yeah. These are all, by the way, turn out to be what they call nowadays chaotic forms, which is kind of a joke, because chaos, what we understand chaos to be, is disorder, but in fact chaos is a kind of order. So we reach the limits of language there too, by the way. This is a kind of these kind of constant whirling motions in every direction wind up producing a kind of chaotic form, which looks like a lot of arabesques that we recognize from things in music or dance or even just two-sided curves, things like
when
that.
When I saw that hanging in the exhibition, and I recalls my penmanship that I had to go through with an inkwell and a point, and you had to make circles.
That's right.
And you continue them. And if you look at the very top, you can see circle. And as you go down and around, you can see the transition or the changes movement has gone through.
Oh, that's wonderful. That's exactly right. It evolves, and it actually evolves. And chaotic fluids in chaos, which is probably where the term was. Chaos was used to describe more than anything, is fluids in chaos, or meaning that it's an order, or rather it takes a certain order, and that is the kind of order that you see there, and it really is affected by revolution, by revolving, and by movement. There's another one. That's another one which sort of.
At first you
points.
Might think they're the same one, but then when you start looking at them, they have different connections that you've made, as far as kind of like a triangular web in this one.
Right. Yeah, and also that kind of braiding effect.
Which is acquired through the erasing.
Exactly. It's acquired through a kind of rhythmic erasing, too. I mean, these are fortuitous events. I do not see them before I do them. They happen with the chalk, and I seize on them as seeing that they're patterns that evolve out of motion, my own motion. And that interests me because, well, I suppose if one wants to feel like you're a galaxy, that's the best way to do it. Oh, now here's this is a very recent work. I did it in 96 last year. It really is a spiral, except it's seen differently. There are three spheres, and they are rotating around each other, and they pile up. These groups of three pile up in another to become another triangular group of three, in a way, and sort of fling themselves out, and they're held down by these three dark circles that I made to sort of hold them down and anchor them in place. But this is a kind of, somebody referred to this, or else Michael Brennan, who wrote a review of this show that this was in, referred to this as God's galactic game plan, which I think is marvelous. I think that it's a very...
It's a atmosphere landscape, so to speak.
I don't know, but it's sort of, well, I guess you might say that. It's a very...
I mean, if you look up in the sky, this is maybe what you could see. When you look at the Milky Way or other things you could imagine.
It depends how much you had to drink, I think. But, but you could see that.
I mean, I don't know that you can see atoms either.
No, that's right. You can't. I mean, I, you know,
you
I really...
bottle of...
Well, you had the same thing you were drinking, whatever it was. But I think that I was always interested in showing what was unshowable. So.
Okay. What are you working on now? What's in your studio now that you're working
paintings.
On?
Paintings.
Paintings?
Yeah.
On canvas?
Yeah, big ones.
And what forms are they?
Same
forms?
Sure.
Gee, I thought maybe there was, what have you added to it? Have you subtracted something? Is it swirling or is it?
No. It's not exactly the same. I it's hard to describe. I mean, I think, well, if we have one more set, I think, of drawings.
Yes, we do.
To show. I think that they're closer to the drawings that we're going to show now. I think the reason is because I became more involved it's hard to express. I became more involved in their physical properties of these things and thought them less and felt them more. And so
you move from the biology to the physics,
yeah,
side of it.
So yeah, and also the palpability of the work. The more palpable it becomes, the more one wants to make painting, the more one wants to make it more real. However you say that, if painting is ever real. The thing that I love about it is that it's an object, very palpably one, but of course it's always an illusion because that's the way we see. I mean, we do not see flat space ever because there's no such thing as flat space. So we see space and we see space and we see an idea of flatness. And those things are responsible for, of course, tons of optical illusions, tons of mental mistakes we make, and they're also responsible for us being able to negotiate our path through this room, through the world. It's a kind of a combination of the visual, physical apparatus that we have, siphoned through our mind or the intellectual apparatus we have, which kind of sort of adjusts everything so that we can handle it.
Okay.
Okay. Anyway, so here are some drawings, I guess.
Okay, we'll go back to the...
Here's some drawings about the adjustment or lack of adjustment thereof. This is another grouping of spheres, but it's hard to see this again, but those dark bands that I picked out were picked out in a kind of a running way. In other words, I went over them because I kept thinking, well, if these things were all lined up in one direction, if they were spinning, I might be able to say they would always line up in one direction. And so I just picked out that movement. And it doesn't show so much in this slide, but it kind of has that feeling as though somehow I've stopped them in time, but they're still going on. Okay. Here's another thing. Now, I call this shadow. This essentially is a funny idea to me. It's as though there's a shadow on top of these spheres. But the shadow doesn't make sense because the shadow is a shadow of spheres but doesn't quite fit. It really winds up being a geometric shadow, meaning that if you parse the spheres with concentric circles, you can fill them in and get something like this. This is different than an actual shadow and doesn't function that way. It rather functions as something, as levels of spheres on top of each other, and you would get something like this. But I called it shadow, and I called it shadow for a reason, because as I was alluding, we were talking about before, I've become interested in, quote, the phenomenal world, the things that you can see, and when you see a shadow, what does it look like? And when is it real and when is it not real? When is it a shadow, when is it not? For example, I've seen, you see reflections on things and they're white sometimes. And you say, well, that's a white shadow. Anyway, we can go on, I can go on forever about these things. Here's something I call river. Now, I lined up these spheres, I started to smear together the chalk as though I were sort of running my hands over the surface of these spheres in two or three different directions. If you notice, it kind of makes a diamond pattern there. Well, of course, it's overlapping spherical movement patterns. And then gradually, the chalk started to sort of accumulate in the middle down the center there. And I thought to myself, God, it's like water running over these things. And maybe when you see water coming out of a tap, you notice how sometimes it spirals around, like in this long stream. And I thought, well, perhaps that's why, because it's in fact taking this kind of, it's going in this sort of spherical, constantly moving pattern, and it lines up in a kind of a curl or something. And then, of course, the line next to it is my thinking about how much I love to make thick and thin lines with the chalk, and how much that always looked like a river to me, a meandering river. And so I put it all together and I call this a river. They are, in other words, my thinking is about types of phenomena. You know, things, unlikely partners.
Now, do you happen to think, what are some activities that you did between going to undergraduate school and going to graduate school for art? Were there some activities that you...
Well, I have to say I went directly from one to the other because I had made such a long time between one and the other. But what did I do?
Yeah.
Well, you're trying to get me to say that I was a comedian, right?
No, but
well,
you...
Well, I experimented with it a little bit.
You were involved, and you found out some things about it, and
stand-up
comedian type of things. And I think that's, you know, we all go through different aspects. We do it in different ways, but you had to experience it in some way. Which is what art is about. It's about life, one's life, and one's relationship.
Absolutely. I had a brief romance with comedy because, well, I have a lot of friends who were still in it and who were very good at it, but I can say I wasn't. I enjoyed laughing, and I love to be made to laugh. So, and I think that comedy basically is truth. And it's just another kind of a popular way to get a philosophy in life, and to get a distance on one's life and what one's doing. And the greatest comedy in the world, you really look at and you think, well, this is true. And the same is true, I mean, it's metaphysics, really. And of course, it's wonderful to laugh. I don't know what else, what to do if you don't laugh. I don't know what you would do except cry a lot.
Well, in your drawings that you have, mm-hmm. or you've done, and they're basically circular forms, mm-hmm. and they have an association because you've used the word or the term balls,
right.
like baseballs.
Right.
So they have a representation to them. Well, some people might say, well, things aren't representational unless they're things that we can recognize. But then in using, like your chalk within your work, those are recognizable forms to you.
Right.
And so as far as placing them and utilizing them, actually it's no different than anyone else working with a photo image or of a representational painting.
Right.
I mean, you're placing them within the confines of the parameter of the surface that you're working on.
Yeah, I think that's true. I think that I'm actually come to think of, you know, laughing a lot is in some ways I'm also making fun of the convention of that people are what reality looks like. I'm also making fun of it, or I'm playing with it. I mean, it's a gentle play, you know, it's not some hard-hitting thing, but it's a gentle play. One, what things really look like. I had a laugh with a friend of mine once who made paintings which were pretty obvious pictures of things, like birds and flowers and trees and so on. And I said, well, I was the realist, you know, and he was the abstract artist. So.
Well, I always have the idea that we're all the same distance from center.
Perhaps, but I think that you know, you have to sort of posit the opposite to understand that you're talking about the fabric in between them, and that's, to me, how I understand the same distance from center. But very often, if you turn the tables, like a good comedy joke, usually turns the tables on reality. So I would be saying that this guy was the abstract artist and I was the realist, which is tantamount to what you said.
Now, what I was leading to was that we have this little drawing from your box, from your book, your sketchbook, and and you can see that these, we can somewhat tell what they are, and they're a moth, and at least that's what you said they were.
Right.
And a lot of times you've used a moth or like a horsefly or something
right.
similar to that,
right.
and you've actually involved it like you have done with the ball.
Right.
With the chalk.
Right.
And it's in a way that it's coming full circle.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's funny. I wish I had brought it. I have a slide. I did a self-portrait once, and it was a wasp balanced on a ball. And that was a cool figure.
That's
was
you,
a self-portrait.
Huh?
Yeah.
Oh.
But I've looked at, I started to do those insects because I actually got bit by a bee and got pretty, and then said, let me see this thing that hurt me so much, you know, and looked at it and saw the great beauty in it, and of course realized that symmetry and that beauty was simply a real world manifestation of the things that I was looking at on a smaller level.
Is this done in chalk?
This is watercolor. It's black watercolor and yellow, I think, or something. It's very simple, and pencil. If you go to the one on top of it is what I was really fascinated by. Well,
we'll see it.
Okay. The pattern of the wings was very much like an interference pattern, which is the kind of things you see in rotating balls, and I was really fascinated by that. I'm fascinated by the great beauty of nature when somehow fortuitously, and I'm sure accidentally, patterns like this are created, stable
patterns. Well,
it's what
we see from it.
That's right.
In other words, what we take
That's
from
right.
it, not from what's totally there, because
right.
we aren't able to take in all of it.
Right.
We're very selective, I think, in many cases. So I would like to mention that we have been talking with Linda Francis. And Linda, you don't live in New York City anymore. You live outside of New York in Johnson.
Most of the time.
Most of the time. And also you help survive by also teaching.
Yeah.
You're an adjunct. At Pratt.
Right.
But you've more or less lived in New York for how long?
Well, I was born in New York,
so
I lived in New York my whole
can't,
life.
So see, she's at it. I even remember when you lived down on Chambers.
Right. I've been all over. I've lived every place in New York. Finally, I figured, well, I have to move, and there's no place in New York I haven't lived, so I might as well move out to the country.
Well, then your husband, Neil, who is an architect.
Right.
And
well, he has an office in the city. So.
Well, yeah, but still he spends a lot of time out there, just like you do.
Right.
With your studio.
Right. But I think if I couldn't get back, basically I need to get back into the city for the stimulation and the culture. It's very different in the country.
Okay, Linda, I would like to thank you for coming and visiting us, and I would like to thank the audience for tuning in.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
Okay. Good night.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530, or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.